deserve. My special guest tonight is the artist formerly known as Yorgos Kyriakos Paniotou. He's a one-time disc jockey at the Bel Air restaurant in Bushy, who became a superstar of modern popular music. He's a boy who worked as a dishwasher in his father's restaurant, who Sir Elton John described as the Paul McCartney of his generation. More recently, he's been in the news because of what's been described as the most public coming out in history. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome, please, George Michael. May we begin?
What a lovely bunch. Yes. They're very large, these Greek families, aren't they?
Well, nice to see you anyway. Good to see you. And good to finally.
I have to say, before we start, actually, I wanted to say that this is a great honour for me because I can remember being, I don't know, 8 or 9 years old, and my mum would allow me to stay up beyond a certain time in the evening only to watch the Parkinson show. She thought it would be a bit of quality watching, so I'm very, very privileged to be here.
Well, that's very, very kind of you. Very kind of you. It's good to have you.
And she probably wouldn't have been quite as thrilled that I had to take my willy out to get on here. I mean, really, really, would I have been on for an hour tonight without that incident?
Well, it'd be sleeping with the producer anyway, but certainly it's... yes, of course you've been on for an hour.
Because I remember calling earlier in the year and they said they could get me a walk-on on Going For A Song. That was about it, you know. Suddenly here I am.
Oh, here you are. Let's talk about that incident which led you to be here tonight. I mean, what happened? What was the...
I think it's fairly well documented by now. I mean, it's something that I've had to talk about for a while just so that I can not have to talk about it in the future, you know. What happened was basically I fell prey to one of these SWAT teams that they have in America. And I think they probably still have them in parts of England. You know, it was a stupid moment, and obviously I've suffered for it.
I suppose a lot of people would ask the question about why you, as a public figure, as somebody who is recognised, both here and in America, why you take such an outrageous risk?
Well, I suppose that's the whole point, isn't it?
Is it?
I think
that's
so. I mean, I think so. I don't know. I mean, to some degree, you know, I was not in the best state of mind and it was a kind of reckless thing to do.
You took the decision, I think, 24 hours after all this was happening with hardly helicopters and news crews, all that said. You decided to go to a restaurant, didn't you, just to make your public declaration. Mm-hmm. Tell me what happened when you were there.
Well, I suppose there's one recurring theme to my actions as a celebrity or as a person, as an adult, and that is if I'm pressured into anything or pressured into a point of view or a certain position, either by individuals or by history, i.e. the way that celebrities normally deal with scandal and shame, you know, or supposed shame, I react against it. And my reaction to this was, I'm not going to be like another one of these people that's peeking out from behind their net curtains a month later, you know, trying to get rid of the press. They were surrounding the house, and I thought, for God's sake, you know, what is the game here? What do you want, a reconstruction? What is it, you know? Why are you all here? So I thought, I'm just going to go out for a meal. I know they'll all chase me. I know they'll just, you know, I know it'll cause, and it did cause havoc. You had all these cars going across red lights and this. And I was just ambling down to my local restaurant, you know. And I just thought that's the only way to deal with it. In fact, someone had said something to me earlier in the day that one of my closest friends said that his mother said, he's not the first, he won't be the last. He's just the biggest. And I thought, well, I like that. I thought, I like that. You can take that anywhere you want.
Sure.
But I thought, if, you know, if, so, and this is, so, and she was, and she's the friend of my mum, and she's in her 60s, so if someone at that age can see it in perspective, from another generation can see it in that kind of perspective, I thought, you know, then pretty much most people probably will. And I really, I gathered confidence over that day and a half, that there really was no need for this to be a disaster.
You obviously talked to friends as well, and you found solace and consolation and inspiration, I suppose, from them. Since you came back from here and came back to England, what's been the public reaction? Has there been any anti-public reaction, for instance?
Well, I was saying to people, 3 or 4 months after the arrest, I could honestly say that if someone had someone had bashed me over the head before I got back from LA and given me amnesia, I wouldn't have known what was going on. All I would have known was that I was signing more autographs. More people were coming up to me in the street and saying, "We love what you do and good luck to you and this and that." And with the exception of a few cars that drive past at 50 miles an hour, you queer bastard. You know? And they're gone before you can even absorb the insult. So it's like, you know, with the exception of that, which might have confused me a little, I wouldn't have known what was going on. I wouldn't have known. Everyone's been so great, you know?
When you called your dad from LA, didn't you?
He called me, actually.
He called me.
Yeah, that was not a phone call I was looking forward to, I have to admit. I don't think it's terribly inhuman of me to admit to that.
But your dad knew, of course, that you're...
Yeah, my dad. I was out with my dad. Yeah.
Of course, that's right. But what did he say to you?
Well, my dad, I mean, he's been great about my sexuality in general. I think, obviously, it wasn't easy for him at first to accept. But I didn't know how he would react, but he basically called me up and said, "Tell them all to sod off." You know, tell them all to sod off. You know, you're who you are. You know, you've got nothing to be ashamed of, and tell them to sod off. And so that's basically what I did.
Let's go back then. You mentioned your dad there, and I mean, he came over from Cyprus as an immigrant, a quid in his pocket, and worked hard, and married your mum, built up a business. What sort of a background was it that you grew up in? What kind of was it? A very close family background?
Very close. It was. My connection with my mother, I spent a lot more time around my mother. So from that point of view, my mother being English and in a strange way, very kind of classless, because she came from a very working class background, but she'd been sent to a convent school because her mother was afraid she was going to be a tomboy. So she was sent to a convent school, which firstly put her straight off religion. And she spoke very well. So she spoke almost with a middle class accent. So I had this kind of really weird thing that I spoke like someone who is relatively middle class, and yet my father was first generation immigrant. So the mentality of the two things, and my mother was also very very British in that she had I get my attitude to money from her, which is always, you know, her attitude to money was that it was something to be afraid of, and that took a long time for me to get rid of that idea, you know. And yet my father's attitude to money was you just grab it and move up, you know?
Yes.
So I had this really strange mixture of cultural ideas and class ideas. Mm. And I didn't actually understand until I was maybe 15 or 16 that I wasn't like a lot of the kids that I was growing up with, because they came from relatively working class backgrounds and had an automatic suspicion of, you know, kind of upward mobility.
Yes.
Which is what my mother had, but it was these two ideas constantly.
But what about the business of being what you are now, the musician, the songwriter? I mean, did you display an early talent for singing or for?
I didn't actually. I got thrown out of the choir.
Did you?
I was thrown out of the choir for I think, as far as I know, it was for talking, and I always remember my dad used to say to me, you know, because I used to say, "Dad," that when I was like, you know, 16, 17, 18, and my dad was threatening to throw me out of the house if I didn't get a job within a certain amount of time. So obviously I went out and got jobs, but I was saying I want to be a singer. You know, I think I'm going to be rich and famous. And he would say, you know, "Everybody wants to be a pop singer. Everybody wants," I said, and I would say, "No, Dad, everybody wants to be a pop singer when they're 12, you know, when they're 12. This is my whole life. This is what I want to do." I've lost my train of thought.
But was it to be rich and famous, your ambition? I mean, was that
No, I think I had two very, very strong ambitions, and they've always fought against one another, always. And one was a passion for music and an ability to communicate through music, and really a sense of purpose through music. And two was this desire to be, and rich and famous is not right, because actually rich never came into it. I actually realized about 6 months ago, someone put a question to me, and I actually realized that at no point during my early life, when I was in all my ambitions, or even when I started to realize my ambitions, at no point did it ever occur to me that one of the byproducts of this would be that I could buy whatever I wanted, right, or, you know, live in a big house, have a flashy car, all the things that are very pleasant, you know. But it really hadn't occurred to me. It never occurred to me. So I didn't want to be rich. I just wanted to be filthily famous.
You know? But why was that? Did you think that would make you more attractive? Do you think that it made was a different human being?
It was like most singers. It was feeling not listened to. Lots of feelings of low self-worth, all kinds of things, all the kind of screwed up things that go together to make someone who becomes well-known.
Well, what was the low self-worth based on, though? It was about your looks, wasn't it? About the way you were?
It was everything. I think my looks didn't help. You know, I wasn't...
Tell us, what did you look like? You look all right now, I've got to say.
I looked kind of like I looked like a curly-haired, fatter version of what I am now. But I don't know if it was really about that. Actually, I probably felt better about the way I looked when I was 17 or 18 than I do now. But it was all kinds of things. It was more this desire to be recognised and like I said, just all the same things. I mean, I haven't met one, and people talk about them, but I have never met a star who didn't come from the same kind of insecurity. You know, it's the things that are missing that make you a star. It's not the things that you have.
You did work for a time in various odd jobs. I mentioned in my introduction you were the DJ at the Bel Air at Bushy. Now, that must have been a hell of a job, that.
It was, yes. I was a DJ. It was my first performances consisted of... I had to say this, every night just before... because basically it was a dinner dance restaurant. It was very, very hip, you know, dinner dance. And I was allowed to play the occasional vaguely disco-y record in between 17 requests for the birdie dance, you know. I had to, when people had finished it, when it was kind of winding down, the kind of dinner thing, if you'd never been there before, you didn't know there was a DJ, because I was stuck behind a big post pillar thing. You weren't supposed to see me, which obviously did wonders for my confidence as well. And every night I would have to say, "Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you've enjoyed your meal. Welcome to the Bel Air restaurant. We hope you'll partake of a little dancing." It was so awful, so awful. And my hands used to get clammy and sweaty every night before I had to do this, because I knew that the moment I stopped talking, all the restaurant noises, all the clinking of glasses, all the cutlery, everything would just go zoom, because everyone would be like, "Where's that coming from?" It was every night, it was the same thing, and I was absolutely hopeless at it. I have no idea how I'm able, or was it almost immediately able, to sing to thousands and thousands of people when I literally just used to shudder at the thought of talking to these few dinner dance people.
What was your earliest attempts at performing musically? Was it busking, wasn't it? That was the...
Yeah, well, earliest... I think I was in a few Scout... Cub Scout gang shows,
yes,
you know, the way...
But serious stuff, I'm talking
about.
But
the first time I really was kind of taking myself seriously, I guess, it was busking. I and a friend who's here tonight, actually, David. We used to... A couple of old fans from the 80s there, Dave. we used to... On Fridays, my parents thought I was at school, but on Fridays, every Friday, David and I would go up to town... And because I lived out in Hertfordshire, and we'd come up to London, and we'd busk all day, and with the money that we made from the busking, we'd go back to David's house, change into our kind of new romantic-y gear at the time. Sorry, and then club, go to a club that night. That was a ritual every Friday, and we used to. I mean, some amazing things happened when I was busking. I mean, we were actually pretty good. We just got crap money, because to get good money, you had to arrive at these certain pitches that the police would leave alone. But to have those pitches, you had to be there at like 5:30 in the morning, which was way beyond the call of duty for me, even at 15. So, so we never used to make any real money. But the little money that we had, half the time people would nick off us, or I'd get bullied or something. There was one time a skinhead wearing this skinhead, huge guy, wearing a bright red Fred Perry jumper, came charging down this escalator, and there's no one else in the station, and there's me and David singing, like, you know, Hey Jude. And he comes charging down, he goes, "Give us your jumper." And I'm like, "Well, this is my best jumper." "Give us your..." And eventually, so I'm standing there, taking off my best jumper, thinking, this is so humiliating. I'm thinking, "Dave, hit him with your guitar." And eventually I have to swap it, and he gives me this red Fred Perry jumper, which is like three sizes too big for me, and obviously is what the police would recognise if they could see him, you know. So I've got this red jumper, and it's freezing cold, so I had to wear it, and I'm wearing it at home with David laughing his head off at me all the way home on the tube, and me sitting there going, "I quite like it, actually." Very proud, even then, I was.
Let's I think time for music, don't you? A little musical interlude. Tell me the song you're going to sing. It's called A Different Corner.
Yeah, it's called A Different Corner. I haven't actually sung this for about 11 years, 10 or 11 years. But I thought it was quite fitting because the song I'm going to play later is the most recent song. But this one, even though people see Careless Whisper as my first solo record, the truth is that Careless Whisper was written when Andrew and I were at school, and it was written for, you know, whatever we turned into. Yeah. But Different Corner was the first thing that I wrote as a solo artist, so I thought it'd be a nice thing to do, just to bring back a few old memories.
Man and your singers await you.
Thank you. Because...
Nice song.
Thank you.
So also, as you said before you sang it, it was a kind of a turning point, wasn't it, in your career, in a sense, when you went solo. But let's go back a bit. Let's talk about those Wham days, because they must
have... Must be.
Yeah, we must. Yeah.
No, I'm not. I have no problem talking about Wham. I have a problem watching Wham. But, you know, I had a great time. I'm really glad the way it all turned out.
What about, so tell us about Andrew and about the meeting him and the effect it had on your life.
Andrew I met when I was 11 years old, 11 or 12 years old, I think 11. I just changed schools. My father, we moved house and I changed schools when I was 11. And Andrew was appointed to look after me. You know when the new kid walks in and stands there looking really sheepish and they say, "Who would like to take care of this?" And Andrew, for some reason, put his hand up and said, "I will, miss." And the rest is history, really. It was a very, very strong, powerful relationship, and it changed my life, and it changed my way of looking at so many things that I really think that without Andrew, I would have been in a totally different place right now.
What happened to Andrew? I mean, where is he?
Andrew's the smart one. Andrew's off surfing in Cornwall. And he really, I mean... He's taken a real bashing over the years, you know, because I'm still here. I sound like Shirley MacLaine in that movie. What's that movie? Postcards from the Edge. Because I'm still here, Andrew gets a constant drubbing. Every time his name comes up in association with me, he almost uniformly gets slagged off. And I think over the years that's had quite a negative effect on the way he views the industry, the way he views those days in Wham. But he decided just to get away from it all and went and lived down by the coast. So I don't see much of him anymore.
In that relationship, I mean, you were the creative sense in the you wrote the songs and that sort of thing. But I mean, what was his contribution then? I mean, why was he so significant?
Well, because he had such a sense of humour. I mean, unfortunately for us, you know, the sense of humour that we had, which was very juvenile, because we were juvenile, you know, I left school. He left a little before me, but I left school and 7 or 8 months later had a record contract. So I was still a kid, you know. And our sense of humour, or our own kind of private sense of humour that I built up over the years, I don't know if we thought everyone else would get it, rather than just thinking we were complete tossers. But, but we were constantly trying to annoy people, and that's Andrew, actually. That's Andrew all over. Mm. Like, you know, with the first album, we're calling the first album Fantastic, and, and oh, God, I just remembered, I have this horrible flashback. Do you remember a couple of weeks ago, actually, you wouldn't have seen it, but on the MTV Awards, Fergie presented an award to a group called Massive Attack, who I'm a huge fan of, and they're fervent anti-royalists, and I like them, and I really like her, because I've met her a few times, and it was a very embarrassing moment for all involved, but basically she went up to give them their award, and they snubbed her, and the two of them went like that to her, right? And the horrible truth is, for at least a year, right, after Andrew and I were first famous, whenever anyone would come up to us we hadn't been introduced to, we'd go, huh. Can you imagine that? Within 12 months, the number of people you can do that to, you can imagine, even if nothing else about us had been annoying, right, we would have been blacklisted by them just for that. But, you know, that was us. I mean, that was, we mucked about like that the whole time, and it was fantastic also in the sense that it kept us both grounded, because we had each other to take the piss out of the whole time. So, but that was something that I've really missed.
But I mean, was it fulfilling in the sense of you know, enjoying yourself? You're a kid. I mean, there was the glamour of it. There was the money. There was the birds. Everything, wasn't there at that time?
There was the whole thing. And I mean, you know, I think we both kind of gorged on not the money side of things. Money, really, I was so afraid of money until probably the age of about 28, 30, that it really, I really didn't live in any way according to the money that I was earning. And it actually, Wham wasn't making any money for it. For the longest time, we were making no money. Our first Top of the Pops, we went home on the bus.
Really?
Yeah. And actually, I remember the night before, we stayed in this little hotel off of Charing Cross Road, because our record company, our little kind of mini record company that we were on at the time, was paying, and so they wanted to make sure that we got there in time for Top of the Pops, the first Top of the Pops. So they stuck us in this hotel that couldn't have been more than 80p to a quid a night. And I was sleeping the night before my first Top of the Pops. I had polystyrene sheets, and it was a child-sized bed. So I was like this. I was sitting with my feet over the end of it, thinking, this isn't how it's supposed to be. You know, I'm supposed to be, you know, if you're on Top of the Pops, that means you're famous.
That's right.
In fact, the day after the first Top of the Pops, I was just convinced that everyone would recognise me, you know. I was walking down the street like... Watch TV last night? Yeah, and it was horrible, because absolutely nobody did. Nobody recognised me. I think it took about 3 days before someone came up and asked me for my autograph, and I was absolutely shattered that it took that long.
This is, of course, the desire to be famous as much as anything else.
Oh, yeah. That's what to be recognised, to be recognized. Loved, I suppose.
And when did that fail to be ultimately fulfilling? When did something else come into life? Which it did, of course. That's why you changed tack. Was there a moment when you were with Andrew? I think
probably the last year of Wham. That's the reason it was cut short, really. That's the reason we stopped when we were in kind of on top, was because that last year I'd had to actually accept the fact that having spent 3 or 4 years, you know, totally promoting and writing and going around the world, touring, doing the whole thing, that I was miserable. And you know, it's the old cliche, you get everything you want, or everything you think you want, and then you suddenly realise that the gap that you thought it would fill is still there. And I think that was a personal thing that took me years and years to resolve. But I did know it after about probably 2.5, 3 years. I knew that this was really not going to, this was not going to make me happy. This was going to keep me famous. And I loved making the music, but actually the whole kind of circus of it was very distressing for me.
Do you play old Wham tapes at home?
No, I can't say I do.
Go on, you do.
I did for a while when the Greatest Hits was out. I'm too busy playing my own records at home. I can't play Wham records. I play George Michael records 24 hours a day. A dog can sing Careless Whisper.
Your dog this afternoon was singing along with you.
My sister does say,
he's looking at the monitor and doing the desk act.
My sister does say that when there was one time, because I leave my dog with family when I'm abroad, and I was in America for about 6 weeks, 8 weeks in one stretch last year. And my sister said actually that the dog used to go and sit by the radio and she could actually hear my voice when one of my tracks would come and she'd go and sit by the radio. But that shows how much I play them at home, doesn't it?
Let's we close the chapter on Wham. Let's be reminded, shall we? This is Top of the Pops, probably the Top of the Pops you're talking about.
Anyway, it's been really nice. But there you go. I mean, those awful T-shirts with number ones that actually my mother and my sister spent all night sewing on little things. I mean, there you go. Apart from looking terrible, how annoying. You know, how annoying must we have been to all those bands at the time that we were competing with that would be that tacky and cheesy to do that. But we thought it was funny. It's just that everyone else thought we were completely for real, you know? That's my version of it.
All right, so then off you went then to the solo career, and I mean that the first record you did, the first CD was Faith, and that was mega success and made you into a mega star. Mm. And I suppose the problem you'd have then, of course, was that you were still, were you not, this pop star, trying to be established as a songwriter, a singer songwriter. You still have this image of the...
Well, one of the things, you know, I mean, I had placed a lot of Wham's kind of scream thing around Andrew, and I really didn't think that if... I did kind of what was coming naturally to me at the time. I mean, Faith, the way I looked in the videos and stuff was pretty much, sad as it is, that was pretty much how I was walking about day to day. I really didn't think that image was going to create that whole same thing again, which is pretty much what it did, especially in America. I got this whole new wave of young fans, predominantly female, and I kind of boxed myself in again without thinking that I had, you know. It was naive of me. When I look back and I look at the videos, obviously the image was going to work, you know. And
yes.
I just thought somehow, because the music was a bit more mature, I was still very young. And when you're 24, I mean... I was 24 when I made Faith, and I thought I was quite mature, because you do when you're 24, don't you? Absolutely. You basically think, you know, I'm not a kid anymore. They'll stop screaming at me. Of course, 24 is like nothing, really. So I was really convinced that I was on a different path, and then it became massive with Faith, and I realised that I was even more miserable than when I'd split up Wham. And the reason that I split up Wham was because I was miserable. So, you know, I'd kind of scuppered myself.
Are you given to depression?
No, I'm not, actually. I'm not. When I was younger, because I suppose I was so confused about my sexuality and other things, I suppose I was prone to loneliness and depression around loneliness, because it is very lonely if you're surrounded by people, but you're not really surrounded by anyone, you know. And I was prone to that. I'm not prone to depression. I'm not a depressive person. People think, you know, a lot of things that have been written about me lately. I mean, the press love to think that all there is in your life is your relationship with the public and them, you know? And I made a real effort in my life over the last 10 years for that not to be the case, to try and make my life a rounded thing without having to interact with the public, so that I could keep making music, so that they would still want something that I was doing. And recently, all the press have kind of taken this attitude, he looks so happy now, we've outed him, you know, we've done him a big favour.
I was going to say this to you.
Well, the fact is, I looked like this, actually years ago I looked happy like this, if anyone remembers, but I've had a really tough decade, really, you know. As I said, I lost a partner, I lost my mother, I lost my dignity, I've lost lots of things. The one thing that I've held on to is that relationship with the public, because somewhere amidst all of that, even if it was me being miserable as opposed to the happy-go-lucky chap I was before, I was still being honest and giving them truthful music. If I tried to remain upbeat through a period where I was going through bereavement, essentially for the best part of 5 years, then it would have been a crap album. You know, I think now I'm happy because, of course, yeah, there's some relief in not having to play the press game over my sexuality, but that's all it was. It was between me and them.
Well, there was that was the worry, was it? I mean, that was when you said you're
worry,
confused.
It was just...
Well, can we just go back on two things?
I will let you interview me, it's all right.
You're doing all right. when you said you were confused about your sexuality, I mean, does that mean to say that you were confused about what you really were?
Well, yeah, I didn't even see it as confused at the time. When I was younger, and of course there was all this availability, there has been a lot of availability since I've been well known. But when I was younger, because there was no emotional attachment to anything, I was seriously underdeveloped emotionally. Never had any crushes on anyone at school, never fell in love at school, had lots of girlfriends, carried on all through the first part of my career. By that time, I knew I was bisexual, and basically I'd had plenty of experience on both sides of the fence, as it were. But I had no emotional attachment, so I had nothing to attach my sexuality to. The day that I knew that I was gay was the day that I knew that I was in love with a man. And yes. At that point, there was no real question for me. I understood what had been missing all this time. Yes. And that could have gone on for a lot longer, you know. Luckily, it finished when I was... that confusion, I suppose, finished when I was about 26.
Yes.
But in that time in between, I wasn't so much thinking I was sexually confused. I just thought I was bisexual. I thought, well, you know, if you can kind of take it or leave it on either side, then you must be bisexual. And now I realise it's got nothing to do with who you can get it up for. It's to do with who you can get it up for and love. You know, yes. That's really the way I feel. I don't feel my sexuality is bisexual. I think I'm gay.
Given given all that's happened to you too recently, I mean, is there nonetheless a kind of sense of relief now that it's in the open? You said before that you'd actually declared it in your music, didn't you?
Well, I felt that there was a general, especially here in England. I think anyone who didn't have a fair old idea that, you know, that I was. I mean, why had no one seen me with a woman for the last, you know... Okay, occasionally, if I'm coming out of a club with a friend or a couple of friends, they'll pick the pretty girl that's on to one side of me and they'll say, George with mystery, this and that. And the press knew I was gay as well. This was the strange thing about it. It wasn't like they were trying to... It's all, until they could get something solid and, you know, really nasty, they were kind of playing the same game that I suppose the public were, which is, well, we don't really want to know. As long as he keeps making the music, et cetera, et cetera. I generally thought that when I walked into a room full of people, they knew I was gay. But definitely over the last 5 years, I've felt that. Mm. But the only relief, really, what I didn't realise was how much energy it took to play this game with the press that was really just about my pride and my privacy. It wasn't about my sexuality because I knew, I felt, and I've always felt that I have a very... strong sense of my audience, and I knew that my audience were not going to desert me if they found out I was gay. You know, I believed and I believe in people more than that. That if they get something rewarding from you emotionally, such as music, that they you know that they are tolerant of certain things, and as well they should be. But I think people generally thought that I thought that if I actually declared that I was gay, I would suffer some huge loss of audience, and I never believed that. I might have believed that back in the days of Wham, but I never believed that. I just had, it was like, me and the press was like two dogs with a bone, you know?
But is that better?
It's like, now that I've let go, and they've done that, yes, it does
you're,
feel
you're
like
you're happy, you're bothered. Yeah. Well, what about, I mean, the other thing that occurred to me is that you came from a very close-knit family. You're a close-knit family still. Have you resolved the problem that you have of not furthering that family, of not having children?
Well, it depends if you see, I think I never really thought it was a problem. When I was younger, I think I did want to have children. When I was like 22, 23, I thought it would be great. I'd see young fathers with their sons, you know, playing football or whatever, and I'd think that's something I'd really like to do. And as I've become older, I really don't know if I would be a great parent. I think I would be I think I'd probably be responsible, but I think I'd also probably be neurotic, and I'd be responsible and neurotic to the degree that I would be miserable. You know, I would have a total sense of responsibility and probably feel selfish doing anything for myself. And I don't think that's particularly healthy. Also, I don't have that desire anymore. I don't think, oh, I wish I had children. I've realised that my sense of purpose has become my music. And I think that creative people are lucky in the sense that maybe if you're a gay person, or if you're a person who is not able to have children for one reason or another, and you don't have a vocation, it probably is an incredibly tough thing, because I think by a certain point in life, most people decide that they've either achieved the ambitions they wanted to or that they're never going to, and they put their sense of purpose into their family, and I think that's perfectly natural and,
yes,
and understandable. I think if you're a creative person, some of that pressure is taken away to fulfill, you know, or to have a sense of purpose, because my sense of purpose still is really a creative one, and I'd like to think that I'll drop dead being creative. You know, I'd love to think that on the day I die, I'll still be working towards something in a creative sense.
Now, you've, of course, what you've done as well, you've turned the incidents in the Will Rogers Park into a commercial success.
I put this little bit on the front of the video, and I made that exact reference, and that we did it in a kind of, we pretended it was a Swedish porn movie. We filmed it properly, but then pretended it was a Swedish porn movie, and I had like a Swedish dialogue going over the top. And we had credits, and we made up words and language for the credits. So I put Offenvanken. And just so not to make it really, really obvious, I turned the O into a U and put a little kind of umlaut thing over the top. Offenvanken. And on MTV, they blurred it out. Like, you can see people get... The things that you see on TV today, the things that people have read about and talked about in connection with me this past 8 months, and they blot out an imaginary word that suggests the word wank. You know what I mean? It's like, I couldn't believe it. It's absolutely stunning.
So, which version are we going to see now?
No, this is seldom vanken now. Actually, I never even think about masturbation before calling my lawyer.
So this is the concert version of
this is a kind of version we thought we could manage tonight in this. We kind of tone it down a bit, and I won't be acting out the video or anything. But this is called Outside.
Outside. There's your group and your... Glad you enjoyed it, so did I. My thanks to George Michael, to his marvellous backing group, the singers and everybody. From all of us here, a very good night. Good night.